Well, good morning. So good to see you this day as we gather and worship, not only in person, but also online. It's a beautiful day outside. If you haven't, well, obviously you're here because you've been outside. But for those online, if you haven't gotten out where you are, hopefully you can, especially in the Wisconsin area. So it's fantastic. What a great day. Our only announcement today is a reminder that the voters meeting that is going to take place after church will be there. We'll be, have a small break and then come right back in. So if you want to stay seated, you can stay seated too. But otherwise, we're going to go with worship then now today. So please, if you would stand as you are able, and we're going to again begin with our worship of our one true God together. Abba, Father, risen Lord Jesus, Holy, warm Spirit, you are here with us. We are broken, following Jesus together, long to glory. And together we confess that we are broken. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. And together again, of course, we receive God's vast grace. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. To those who believe in Jesus Christ, he gives the power to become children of God and bestows on them the Holy Spirit. May the Lord, who has begun this good work in us, bring it to completion on the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. And now together we take opportunity to confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. Together, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Now, again, as we get ready here, we're going to go ahead and sing then our first one about being amazed.
You dance over me while I am unaware. You sing all around, but I never hear the sound. Lord, I'm amazed by you. Thank you.
Have a seat. So, if you have been a part of New Hope for many, many years, you came into New Hope through what we call First Connections. So yesterday, Pastor Greg was working with a new young couple through First Connections. So if you joined a month ago, a year ago, 5 years ago, some of you 10, 15, 20, 25 years ago, we use what we've called for a lot of years First Connections. Usually there's four blue sheets. I love the color blue, kind of the color of New Hope, the symbol of hope. So First Connections, we have beginning faith connections, basic faith connections, belief faith connections, and finally beyond faith connections. And over all those years of teaching First Connections and bringing people in, we've used this Lego deal. And again, I know it's a lot of years ago because my son, our son Jared's going to turn 40 this year, and he probably stopped playing with Legos probably around 14, 15. So this is a piece that's 35 years old. So it represents God. This is God. Again, this amazing God, the symbol of hope, and we just know that the kingdom of God is already in existence. It's always been in existence. And so this green one represents this earth. And we are about to see everything around us pop green. The grass is going to get green. Trees are going to get green. So there's going to be a lot of green. And so when we pray, "Thy kingdom come" in the Lord's Prayer, we're not praying for this kingdom. We live here in this kingdom, but we are praying for this kingdom to come. And then we talk about this black piece. It represents us men. Most of the difficulties around the world today have been instigated by men. So we know that men live on this earth. We are born on this earth, and we continue to exist on this earth. The red. Again, you lovely ladies, we know that you still sin. But we also know that as you sin, you still don't cause as much trouble as these pieces here. So again, you're attached to this earth, you're born to this earth. And we all kind of know that even the atheists know they got to oftentimes be real, real angry and fight against God. But everybody kind of knows that there's something more. There's something more. And then we ask these questions as we're introducing this. How does connecting more fully to God happen? And then why connect to God more fully. And as we read through the scriptures and all of the stories that are in the scriptures about the men and the women who follow God from kind of a beginning point to what will be their end point, we over and over see that they end up connecting more fully to God. Something that is always boggling our mind is when God says to Abraham, take your son, your only son Isaac, and go sacrifice him. And our minds are just kind of blown with that. But Abraham has been following and trusting and learning to trust in God for decades. And so when he hears God's command, he just goes and obeys it. And as we know, God stops him. But that is the kind of faith that God puts in over and over and over, and people grow with that faith. My faith has been growing all these years. Your faith has been growing, and it will continue to grow as we are following Jesus over and over again. And then after kind of that introduction, we end up having what we call a conversation about faith. Again, we all have a church faith story. So we just kind of ask, what's your church faith story so far? And I share mine, and they share theirs, and lots of different backgrounds. People that have grown up Lutheran, people that have grown up Catholic, people that have grown up, actually these days we had a number of people over the last number of years haven't really grown up anything and just grown up Baptist and Methodist, and again, you just name it, non-denominational, they're all out there. So we all have a story, and our story is brings us to this point. Now, what's our story going forward as we're following God and connecting with God? And after that, we get into the big question. It's the question for all people, the question for everyone watching online. Many of the people that are watching online, they came through First Connections, some of them years ago. But who is God? And I always introduce it with this idea. When you think of God, is there a temperature you would give to your relationship with God? Is it cold? Is it hot? Is it warm? Again, one of the concepts of God, a kind of a popular concept that's out there, that God is this old man in a rocking chair far, far, far away. And that just kind of leaves you cold. Why would you want to get together? Why would you want to get close to an old man that just kind of sitting out in a rocking chair far away? Maybe some of you, like my story, and maybe you're dad abandoned you, and you never really had a relationship with a warm, nurturing, earthly father. And there's just all kinds of other things that can leave us cold. And some of you, you had a hot father. Maybe you had a hot mother. I mean, they were just angry. I'll hear the stories of, you know, the hot pastor, the fire and brimstone pastor. And so your picture of God is that he's hot. And again, why would you want to get close to a hot, angry God? Who is God? What if he's warm? All of us in our lives, we work to stay warm. There's no place in the world where people do not sleep without a blanket at night, even in the warmest of climates. Because it always gets a little cooler at night, doesn't it? God can be like a blanket, warm. God can bring us back to warm if we get real, real hot and angry at this world. God can bring us back to warm if there's kind of cold and frozen stuff that has happened in our lives. And then we go to this Bible verse, Exodus 34, verse 6. Let's read it together for those online. Let's read it out loud, even as you're watching the screen. So all of us. And he passed in front of Moses, proclaiming, the Lord, the compassionate and gracious God, slow to anger, abounding in love and faithfulness. God is speaking these words to Moses up on the mountain in Sinai. And this is the second time that Moses has gone up the mountain. He went up there for 40 days and got the Ten Commandments, came back down to the Ten Commandments. The people of Israel had started chasing after a false idol, the golden calf, threw the commandments down. God calls him back to the mountain a second time, got to replace the tablets of the Ten Commandments. But also speaks these words for Moses to record, for us to know who is God. We listen to who God says he is. Not a mother, not a father, not a pastor, not anybody else. We need to listen to who God says he is. Not the things that we can make up in our own minds, how what we think about God, but who is God. So Exodus 34 verse 6 is what we call a Bible thread. When you pull on this Bible thread, it keeps happening through many other verses. And then we finally will see it happening in Jesus. No surprise, Jesus, he's compassionate and gracious. And then the followers of Jesus are supposed to be compassionate and gracious. So there's going to be a number of verses up there. I'm going to go through them real quick. Numbers 14:18. Again, sometimes just an echo. The Lord is slow to anger, abounding in love. 2 Chronicles 30. For the Lord your God is gracious and compassionate. Nehemiah 9. You are a forgiving God, gracious and compassionate, slow to anger, abounding in love. Psalm 86. But you, O Lord, are a compassionate and gracious God, slow to anger, abounding in love and faithfulness. These verses are being put into God's word 100 years after Exodus 34, 200 years, 300 years, once they have come into the promised land, once they have conquered the promised land, once they have lost the promised land. This Bible thread just keeps appearing over and over again. Again, in Psalm 103, the Lord is gracious and compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love. Psalm 145, the Lord is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and rich in love. The Lord is good to all, he is compassionate in all he has made. Joel 2:13, rend your heart, not your garments, return to the Lord your God. He's gracious, compassionate, slow to anger, abounding in love, and he relents from sending calamity. My favorite use of this Bible verse, this Bible thread, is in the last chapter of Jonah. We're going through the book of Jonah in our Common Ground class with a Right Now Media presentation. But here's what happens. This is after Jonah has been in the whale and out of the whale, and he's gone through Nineveh, and God has shown himself exactly this. But Jonah was greatly displeased and became angry. He prayed to the Lord, Lord, is this not what I said when I was still at home? That is why I was so quick to flee to Tarshish. I knew that you are a gracious and compassionate God, slow to anger and abounding in love, a God who relents from sending calamity. And I hate it that you have forgiven these people. So now, Lord, take my life, for it is better for me to die than to live. The Lord replied, have you any right to be angry? And he warms the soul of Jonah again. And then no surprise, when we come across one of the episodes of Jesus in Matthew chapter 9, we read this. Jesus went through all the towns and villages, teaching in their synagogues, preaching the good news of the kingdom and healing every disease and sickness. And when he saw the crowds, and compassion on them because they were harassed and helpless like sheep without a shepherd. So when you look at Jesus, when you think about Jesus, when we watch Jesus and all the stories, is there ever a moment where he is not compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, even when he gets angry, abounding in love and faithfulness? And then the followers of Jesus, we read this in 2 Corinthians, praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of compassion and the God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our troubles so that we can comfort those in trouble with the comfort we ourselves have received from God. And finally, James 5, our Lord is full of compassion and mercy. So as we pull on Exodus 34, 6, from Exodus 34 all the way through Revelation and right up to this day, with this good and warm Bible thread, we ask ourselves then this question. How is God, the Lord, compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love and faithfulness to me, to each one of you, to each one of you watching online? How is he that to me, to you, to all people? people? We'll come back to this question. What we do next in our first connections, beginning faith connections, is what we call the timeline illustration. And the idea is how our brief story connects to God's eternal story of compassion, grace, love, and faithfulness, and how it is strong and eternal, and that there is never a day, never a moment, when God is not compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love and faithfulness. So over there is some beginning. There is no beginning to God, but we know that sometime there has been a beginning when God created, let there be, and there was. And lots of times in our day and age, we get excited with this whole idea. Well, is it 6,000 years ago? Is it 100,000 years ago? Is it millions and millions and billions of years ago? I don't know. You don't know. The greatest minds in this world don't know. It's always a theory, but we know there is a beginning no matter when it happened. And even before God said in Exodus 34, 6, that I'm the Lord, compassionate, he was already that. And he's still that today. And so on this timeline, all the way to the beginning, and then there's going to be all the way, and we know that we'll have a marker on our grave, that there will be a date we began and a date we end, but we believe in the forever of Jesus. And we just have this little time. For on Easter, I showed you my grandparents' gravestone. My grandfather, his marker reads 1900 to 1981. He wasn't quite 81 yet, he was just 80. So he had 80 years. And he believed in the Lord, the compassionate and gracious God, slow to anger, abounding in love and faithfulness, even when his youngest son at 14 died of a brain tumor. There is never a day, never a moment when God is not compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love and faithfulness, even when we don't understand it. Don Francisco created an album of music in 1977. It's Forgiven. Lori and I got that. This is kind of the early years of the Jesus music. Had been around maybe in existence, not quite even 10 years yet. So we had it, have this record album, and then got it on cassette when that was out, and then CD, and now we just kind of watch it YouTube. There's a favorite song from this album that I've listened to every Easter Sunday morning. It's kind of my early Easter morning worship warm-up song. I'm just listening to it by myself. Over speakers, I used to have a cassette Walkman and with plugs, and then my iPhone with plugs. And this year, you know, Alexa, play He's Alive by Don Francisco. So on early Easter Sunday morning, before you get here, and oftentimes before the music team and the tech guys get here, I'm listening to it multiple times and just worshiping. The song is written and sung from Peter's Easter story morning, his first Easter story morning. So listen and follow along with the lyrics of this fresh 40-plus-year-old song. Listen.
The gates and doors were barred, and all the windows fastened down. I spent the night in sleeplessness and rose at every sound, half in hopeless sorrow and half in fear the day would find the soldiers breaking through to drag us all away. And just before the sunrise, I heard something at the wall. The gate began to rattle and the voice began to call. Hurried to the window and looked down into the street, expecting swords and torches and the sound of soldiers' feet. There was no one there but Mary, so I went down to let her in. And John stood there beside me as she told us where she'd been. She said they've moved him in the night, and none of us knows where. The stone's been rolled away, and now his body isn't there. We both ran toward the garden, then John ran on ahead. We found the stone and the empty tomb, just the way that Mary said. But the winding sheet they wrapped him in was just an empty shell. And how or where they'd taken him was more than I could tell. Well, something strange had happened there, but just what, I did not know. John believed a miracle, but I just turned to go. Circumstance and speculation couldn't lift me very high, 'cause I'd seen them crucify him, then I saw him. Back inside the house again, the guilt and anguish came. Everything I had promised him just added to my shame. When at last it came to choices, I denied I knew his name. And even if he was alive, it wouldn't be the same. Suddenly the air was filled with strange and sweet perfume. Light that came from everywhere drove shadows from the room. Jesus stood before me with his arms held open wide. And I fell down on my knees and just clung to him and cried. He raised me to my feet, and as I looked into his eyes, love was shining out from him like sunlight from the skies. Guilt in my confusion disappeared in sweet release. And every fear I'd ever had just melted into peace.
So by the time church starts, I've already been to church. So Easter Sunday morning, he is alive. So when Peter and John get back from seeing the empty tomb, the words of the song are, back inside the house again, the guilt and anguish came. Everything I'd promised him just added to my shame. When at last I came, it came the, when at last it came to the choices, I denied I knew his name. Even if he was alive, it wouldn't be the same. And how true that is. It wouldn't be the same, but not as Peter thought it wouldn't be the same. But suddenly the air was filled with strange and sweet perfume. Light that came from everywhere drove shadows from the room. And Jesus stood before me with his arms held open wide. And I fell down on my knees and just clung to him and cried. He raised me to my feet again. And as I looked into his eyes, as you look into his eyes, love was shining out from him like sunlight from the skies. Guilt in my confusion disappeared. In sweet release, and every fear I'd ever had just melted into peace. boom, boom, boom. He's alive. He's alive. He's alive, and I'm forgiven. Heaven's gates are open wide. So back to Exodus 34, verse 6. And he passed in front of Moses, proclaiming, I'm the Lord, the compassionate and gracious God, slow to anger, abounding in love and faithfulness. So back to our question, how is the God, the Lord, compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love and faithfulness to me? Where there's never a moment that he's not. There's never a day that he's not. We enjoy celebrations. And how do we enjoy those celebrations? Where do they come from? Are they not a gift from the Lord, compassionate, gracious God, slow to anger, abounding in love and faithfulness? So when the births of children and grandchildren, oh, the celebrations, when we are celebrating birthdays and graduations and weddings and anniversaries, when we travel and we take in the wonders of God's majestic creation, as we're into spring and I was watching some robins over the yesterday and this morning, and then there's squirrels and there's rabbits and our dogs and our cats, and then as all the green and the blue pop, and then there's music, this song, and lots of other songs, and lots of other music. And then what about food and drink and following Jesus with beauty and goodness and truth and wisdom to me, to you, to you? All of that is from his hand, this God who is compassionate, gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love and faithfulness. And we know we can do all of those things and never give him a thought. But what if we do all those things and give him a thought? But also, how are these words true when suffering is in our lives? And not just with a little weight, but with the full weight of anybody have any family dysfunction? Any crazy uncles, aunts, grandfathers that were alcoholics or drug addicts? Any divorces in the room? Any children, not adult children, not following Jesus in the room? What about maybe some of us aren't slow to anger? I mean, we're going to be real nice in this room, but as soon as we get back with our family, with our children, the anger. What about health issues? I mean, how many kinds of ways can we get health issues that will change our life forever? What about what we hear a lot about today, mental health issues? Anybody that's been afflicted with dementia and Alzheimer's? How about all the LGBTQ issues? And then, of course, there's politics, and tax day. And then there's Russia, Ukraine, Israel, Hamas, and now Iran is also in that picture. How is the Lord, compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love and faithfulness to me in all of that? But he is. I don't understand it. You don't understand it. When our son was serving as a Marine and was over in Iraq, and some of you have read his book, the Lord was compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love and faithfulness. And there was a fellow Marine that came back in a box when they brought him home. Other Marines lost arms and legs, and other Marines lost the battle of PTSD and took their lives. But in all of that and so much more, there is never a moment, never a day, when the Lord is compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love and faithfulness. So we end like this. He's alive. He's alive. And I'm forgiven. And heaven's gates are open wide. To what? What are heaven's gates open wide to? Now we just see dimly. The Lord, compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love and faithfulness. But in glory, all the celebrations that we know now and all the sufferings that we know now pale in comparison of knowing the God who is right now, never a day, never a moment, not. The Lord, compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love and faithfulness to me, to each one of you, those who are watching, to those who don't believe in him at this moment or follow him at this moment. He wants to be. And he always will be. Do you know him? Will you follow him? This green kingdom is passing, and all the people, including you and me. Not today, probably. Not tomorrow. Maybe not this year or next year. But my day is coming and your day is coming. When we pray, thy kingdom come. Bring your kingdom. Because you're the Lord, compassionate, gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love and faithfulness. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, oh Abba Father, and holy, warm Spirit, in this very, very broken world that we live in, we ask that you would continue to help us. When all is good, and the weather is spectacular, and the sun is shining, you are the Lord, compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love and faithfulness. And when it is not, and when the weight, the suffering in our own lives, the suffering of this world that comes at us, the suffering that happens close to us with our families, with our children, whether they're young, whether they're old, hold us. And help us to know that even in the moments when this world squeezes the breath out of us, we know. We know. So Jesus, you came and you were in every moment. When you were suffering, going to the cross, you were the Lord, compassionate and gracious. When you took the last breath on the cross, you were the Lord, compassionate and gracious. When you arose on that Easter Sunday morning, you were the Lord. And when you ascended, you were the Lord. And when you come back, oh, the fullness, compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love and faithfulness. Thank you, Jesus. It's in your name we pray. Amen. When Jesus was at the table on that Maundy Thursday evening, he took a piece of that unleavened bread. It's a story of God's compassion and grace to the Israelites. He's going to bring them out of the land of Egypt and eventually bring them into the promised land. But now all these years later, there's been lots of ups and downs in those people not following God. But now Jesus is on the scene. And he brings the pure, unleavened bread. So he prays and he breaks it and he passes it to his friends and says, take and eat. This is my body. It's going to be broken for you. Do this to remember me. Follow me. Takes the cup of wine. Blood of the Lamb. But now the blood of the Lamb. And he prays and he passes the cup to his friends and says, take a drink of this, all of you. This is my blood. My last will and testament. It will be shed for you for the remission of your sins and that you might know. There's never a moment, never a day when I'm not the Lord, compassionate, gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love and faithfulness. So we get to come and receive this holy gift, not once, but over and over again, and every time, the gift is there for us more than how we receive that gift or think or feel. Receiving God's compassion and grace. So let's pray the Lord's Prayer and let's pray for his kingdom to come. We pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. As you come forward, if you have dollars for our friends over in Southeast Asia that we'll be celebrating after communion, you can put those dollars in the basket. I'll be down here to bless the children. And so we continue to worship the Lord, compassionate, gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love and faithfulness.
Truly, I
everlasting love that welcomes me, the kindness of mercy that bought with blood wholeheartedly my soul undeserving. God, you're so good. God, you're so good. God, you're so good. You're so good to me. Behold the cross, age to age, and hour by hour, the dead are raised, the sinner saved, the work of your power. God, you're so good. God, you're so good. God, you're so good. You're so good to me.
I am blessed.
I am called.
I am healed.
I am whole. I am saved in Jesus' name. Highly favored, anointed, filled with your power, the glory of Jesus' name. I am blessed, I am called, I am healed, I am whole, I am saved in Jesus' name. And should this life bring suffering, Lord, I will remember what Calvary has bought for me, both now and forever. God, you're so
Let's pray together. Gracious God, you are so good. Over and over and over again, so good, so good, so good. Thank you for blessing us, blessing our souls with the wonder of the body of Jesus and the blood of Jesus, evidence of the Lord, compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love and faithfulness, and you will continue to do that in our lives, in the lives of others that we know and love, and in many other lives. So Jesus, we look to you. Help us to keep following you. We pray it in your name. Amen. Hey, before we sing our last song, we get to celebrate. So we've been doing motorbikes for Jesus over the last number of weeks. And so today, let's see what happened with motorbikes for Jesus. I think there might be, $10,519. Thank you, New Hope. Thank you, New Hope. Again, just for a quick moment, that picture is like 5 years old. That was before COVID, 2019. Faya in the blue, Pastor Sesu that I was just with in Vietnam, Pastor Na that's from Laos, Pastor Ching from Laos, Pastor Cha from Laos, and then Pastor Zong from Vietnam, and so I was with Zong in Seisu. So here's this month's video report from Fung in Clea.
Welcome to Thailand! During the month of March, we've spent most of our time traveling and visiting our partner churches in Thailand. This morning, we are up on the mountain at Mount Village, as you can notice of the noise of the insects and the roosters, all that. And we are here to worship with a congregation here.
We were able to go to one of our churches here in Chiang Rai and to worship with them. And I also had the opportunity to teach the kids about Noah. And Phong had the opportunity to teach the congregation about who God is. We also had an opportunity to help with the young couple's wedding. The young man is a Hmong evangelist from America, and he is marrying a Hmong lady here up in the mountain. We were able to help with the logistics of the Hmong wedding.
While we were traveling in Thailand, do God's work, Hmong pastors and evangelists also traveled in their own country, witnessing the word of God wherever they went. And here are the results of their evangelist efforts. Pray and hope that you are rejoicing with us for all these blessings. And we have a very small special need to share with you. It is the need of helping finish a house for one of our evangelists. His name is Nushua. He serves a congregation in Thailand. For the past 10 years, he's been serving faithfully, volunteering his time serving the congregation, while at the same time working hard to build his family a house. Finally got enough money to build a house, but he ran out of the fund to finish the foundation, the floor, and other things that need in the house that you can see in here. We would like to invite you to pray and financially support Nushua to finish his house here for him and his family to live. And here are words from Nushua and his wife.
Greetings. I am Evangelist Nushua. I'm pastoring this congregation in Kong Hoi Klai, and this is our little house. We finished most of the things that needed to be finished, but still have a lot of things that aren't finished, like the floor outside and inside and many places. We ask that you pray for us and help us to finish our house. Thank you.
We pray and hope that you will pray for Nushua and provide financial support to help him finish his house for him. Thank you so much. In the month of April, we'll be returning to the U.S. for furlough, and our furlough schedule actually will be starting in May until August. So you have plenty of opportunities to get us to your church to hear about what the Lord has been doing in Southeast Asia for the past couple months. It is exciting work, and we can't wait to share it with you. So get out to your church, and we look forward to seeing you at your home church.
Thank you for your prayers and financial support for the month of March.
And we look forward to seeing you next video from America.
Bye. Bye.
So a number of months from now, you're going to see a motorbike on one of these videos, and it will be one of the motorbikes that you donated so that they can go to another place and talk and witness about Jesus, and another baptism, and another baptism, and another baptism. The wonder of that. This last screen, this is from this last week, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday from 6 a.m. to 8 a.m. I was on screen with Fung. He was translating. We were reading through the book of Hebrews. You can see Pastor Zong to the right of me, and then Pastor Sesu is right underneath there. There were 50 screens, over 125 people reading the Word of God in the book of Hebrews. They were reading it from their Hmong language, either from a paper Bible or from a smartphone. And I was obviously reading it in English. And we had a wonderful number of the people that are on the screen. I also was able to be with in person in Vietnam. So God is doing a work. Why don't we stand and sing our last song, please?
Through every battle, through every heartbreak, through every circumstance, I believe that you are my fortress. You are my portion. You are my hiding place. I believe you are the way, the truth, the life. I believe you are the way, the truth, the life. I believe through every blessing, through every promise, through every breath I take, I believe that you are provided.
We're going to take about a 5-minute break, come back in for the voters assembly and take care of that business, and then continue on with lots of activities going on with our connection land, with our common ground, and the things that you get to do today. So with that, let's go out with Christ in us, the hope of glory.